Hello, everyone. I am Chenille Lafayette, and this is Interconnected, a new podcast and video series on YouTube exploring the hidden infrastructure behind our connected future. We're diving deep into the wiring to explore how and why powerful digital infrastructure is the backbone of today's most game-changing innovations. From agentic AI to quantum computing to autonomous vehicles, none of it works without the invisible systems running underneath. This series is brought to you by Equinix, the world's digital infrastructure company. Interconnected is designed to become a go-to guide to the complexities of digital infrastructure and how today's megatrends are building the digital future for tomorrow. Now, today's episode, we're going to get to know each other a little bit better. Kyle and Glenn, I've met you before, but we haven't really formally chatted, and I'm looking forward to today's conversation. We're going to be unpacking some of the tech disruptions we're really excited about and we're obsessed with. So, Glenn, please tell us a little bit more about yourself.
Thanks, Chenille. My name is Glenn Deckhaser. I've been in the industry for about 35 years, focusing mostly on storage, data management and data technologies, and other issues such as data privacy and governance. So I get to talk to customers and our product team and our marketing team, and I get to see what everybody is doing and contribute.
Yeah, you know, I'm looking forward to everything that you have to say. Before we get into that, Kyle, I want to give you a chance to introduce yourself as well.
Yeah, thanks, Chenille. So I'm Kyle Hilgendorf. I got my start in a corporate enterprise data center for a Fortune 150, kind of cut my teeth there, touched a lot of servers and storage and networks, and early days with VMware and public cloud architecture. So I did that for about 10 years. And then I spent 11 years as a industry analyst at Gartner covering all things public cloud. I'm actually looking forward in this podcast to talking to these incredible thought leaders that are at the forefront of the intersection of these disruptive technologies with real outcomes in the world, whether it be within healthcare or manufacturing, right, or education, and really talk about the implications and how that all comes together.
Yeah.
Now, a little bit about me. I'm a solution strategy lead here at Equinix, and I'm especially passionate about smart infrastructure and sustainability. And just a quick little tidbit, I'm really interested in seeing how in the long term we can bring net zero energy buildings to Jamaica, where I'm from. But I'm so excited to jump in and talk about some of the disruptions. Kyle, I heard from a little birdie that agentic AI is something that you're truly interested in. Like, what is that? Tell us what that really means.
Yeah, I am spending a lot of my mental cycles looking at agentic AI, and it is definitely the phrase and the movement that a lot of technologists are paying attention to right now. So, you know, if let me maybe just describe it in its simplest fashion in case any watchers or listeners aren't quite sure. So I think most of us are pretty familiar with generative AI. So this would be, I would say, more basic and consumer assistive AI, where we provide a prompt as a human. And it's a very much like prompt and wait, a very reactive model. Agentic AI is kind of the era we're heading into now, where it's much more proactive, and we're seeing multiple AI agents starting to work together and autonomously without any human interaction. So these agents are starting to communicate, to take on difficult or significantly complex tasks.
Complex tasks like what? Like in our day-to-day lives? Are you talking about like as you are working with clients? Like, give me an example of how we're sending these over now.
Yeah, so I think we're starting to see like steps towards this. I wouldn't say like maybe we've seen a perfect agentic AI implementation, but we're seeing a lot of it in customer service, where you as a consumer or a customer are having a problem with something and you're submitting that request, and on the back end, multiple different agents are kind of working together to triage and use multiple different data points together to try to resolve your situation. So it's not just like I need a password reset, which would be maybe the most simplistic situation, but I'm locked out of my account. And then there's several steps that have to be taken. I know we'll get into this in later episodes, but autonomous vehicles are kind of the epitome of like a very sophisticated agentic AI solution, where they're taking a look at a lot of different traffic, logistics, GPS, and routing solutions, like what Waymo is doing with autonomous vehicles. So it runs the spectrum. I think we'll get into maybe some of like the real business value of agentic AI, because a lot of the examples we're hearing are consumer oriented. But I think it's like moving AI from cool and fun to probably generating business value.
Like finance.
Finance or manufacturing. Think about the manufacturer who has to source materials from all different types of suppliers. And just-in-time inventory has been something that's been around in factories for a very long time. And there's been a lot of logistics involved in that. Think about the automation and autonomy that could be brought to that, like inventory in their factories. When something is getting low, an agent goes out and asks a supplier to send more. The agent at the supplier says, we're running low on inventory. And the agent back at the manufacturer says, well, okay, great. Well, then I'm going to order from a different supplier. And there's that becomes a spider web of all of these different pieces and parts and the logistics and supply chain of where they sell their product to, and it talking to either retail shops or dealerships or whoever. Like, it's just very exciting.
I don't know. Are we ready?
I don't think it's the question of being ready or not. We got to be ready. And right. I think that there's good work being done around trying to get our hands around, you know, the governance and the sovereignty of that stuff. It's not just going to be a wild, wild west, right? There's going to be some order to it. And it's going to be really cool when we get this stuff in production.
Glenn, you know what? I feel like this is a good segue into data sovereignty, which is something I believe you're really interested in. I know we touched on it a little bit, but like, let's hear your take on that.
So data always belongs to the person who it's about, right? So your input into ChatGPT, that's, you own the data, right? So you're always a data owner. But then what happens is that processor, that whether it's ChatGPT or someone else, right? They store that data in their systems, right? And that system could be in the same country you're in, or perhaps not. Sovereignty refers to the ability that, you know, that data is subject to the laws of the country that you live in, because you're the person who owns that data. So if you're an American and someone stores that data out in the UK, the United States still, the laws of the United States still apply, and the privacy laws of the United States still apply to that data, even if it's sitting in the UK. And so what you're hearing a lot now is, you know, you got a lot of countries that for, you know, many reasons are really getting concerned that the data that belongs to their citizens is not under the control of their laws. It kind of escapes. And once it's out, it's gone. So there's a move for many countries to start to create their own, what they're calling sovereign clouds, right? Mm. Sovereignty is something that most of these countries are starting to be very concerned about. Now, when you marry that with all the things that Kyle was talking about before, hey, we got a world coming up where we're going to have agents talking to each other autonomously.
Across the world.
Across the world, and, you know, on networks. And meanwhile, we've got this, you know, kind of counterbalancing, you know, physics of sovereignty and governance, all the regulatory stuff.
Yeah, Glenn, I'm curious. I mean, I've covered this industry, the cloud industry, you know, for a decade. And I find it so incredibly difficult to keep track of all of the unique privacy laws in even just like the big 15 or 20 countries. And I'm thinking about multinational corporations that are in so many North and South American and European and Asia Pacific countries. Like, is half the battle just keeping track of what they should and shouldn't do or can and can't do? And has there ever been any movements on making that easier?
Well, not making it easier. In fact, I think what you'll find is you've got I did a graph using ChatGPT, ironically, I asked it to give me every known regulation on data privacy, governance, sovereignty, right? Everyone you could think of at any level. And it was a hockey stick. It was starting in like 1980 something, and it goes like this, like straight up. And as you get closer to this year, it's almost a vertical line up of how many new regulations are coming up. And you look at the most stringent ones that there are out there. It used to be that GDPR was the one that people focused on. That is no longer, according to my sources, by a long shot, the most stringent one.
Really?
You have Singapore, South Korea, and some others. And even within the EU, you got like Italy and Germany. But supposedly South Korea is really, really tough. China's tough. And Singapore have the most stringent ones. So the idea is that follow those, and it becomes it subsumes a lot of the other stuff, right? Because you can't, to your point, you can't like keep track of every single little one. But at some point, you kind of do if you're operating in that country.
You know, data sovereignty still applies to something I'm interested in, the creator economy. I'm a creator myself, so like I have my own personal perspective as well as like I'm seeing much larger creators out there. I just wanted to give you like a quick understanding of like what is going on behind the scenes.
I would love to know that.
Yeah.
I consume a lot of golf YouTube content, and it's actually quite entertaining. And I know there's probably a ton that goes in behind the scenes on that. So enlighten us on it.
I'm going to give you what it looks like to create a 15-second video for me. I'm going ahead. I'm shooting probably like 30 minutes worth of videos to create a 15-second video. Think about that, right? 4K, editing it in a tool called DaVinci Pro. And then I'm running it through an AI tool because I realized, okay, well, you know, 4K and 8K content doesn't work well with Instagram. It doesn't work well with a TikTok. So I need to be able to compress that, but compress it in a way where it still keeps the quality of my video. People are not thinking about what's happening behind the scenes, but like when a 30-second video is now created in a minute rather than an hour, and we're able to pump this out, like that's going to change, right? You're talking about massive compute power and storage required. Am I wrong? How is our infrastructure even going to be able to support that?
Yeah, so the storage, talk about that first. There's a term called the data sphere, and there's reports out there about how big that's going to get. And they said that we were going to get to about 25 zettabytes by 2025 this year.
Zettabytes.
I think we passed that by a lot. I think they vastly underestimated it. And the dynamic you're talking about, which is, you know, AI is not going to be just creating data like it's going, like it just isn't going to stop. It's going to be a data output machine.
Right.
So the storage manufacturers are responding to this. Solidigm just came out with a 122 terabyte flash drive. 122 terabytes. Think about it.
Wow.
One flash drive.
One drive. 122 terabytes, right? You've got, you know, new tape. By the way, it is 2025, and I just did say the word tape. It matters. It's still very, very in play here.
Yeah, and the industry will find a way to either make the technological breakthrough or to charge to such a point to monetize the expansion of the infrastructure needed. And, I don't know this industry that well, but I think creators will self-select into, right, or the size of content based on how much it's costing them to create or how much they're monetizing and getting back for it. So it's kind of a cycle of, if I can create content that people will pay for, I get ad revenue and it brings in a certain amount of revenue, and I can pay a streaming service that revenue that I'm getting to get into a bigger tier. And if you don't, then you'll self-select out of that. And I think it will somewhat stay in check.
Right. I'm pretty sure these platforms they're leveraging Akamai and Cloudflare and their internal networks, but do they have the infrastructure that's going to ensure that the content can load quickly and reliably, and so that, you know, everyone is winning? It's not just the brands, it's not just the creators, but also the platform itself. Like everyone has a stake at this point in time. And I think it's a lot of this is going to depend on the tools that we're using as well as the platforms that we're using to share as well.
Yeah, I think the good news is that the companies that you mentioned, the one thing they do well is scale. They have no choice but to keep up. So you got to keep doubling bandwidth, and you got new network technologies that are going to increase the number of lanes on that highway. It's going to keep doubling and keep doubling. I think the infrastructure is going to keep up as long as there's money in it.
So I think we can all agree that tracking today's megatrends can get really exciting. And here's the best part, guys. We're just getting started. So whether you're building the future, strategizing around it, or just want to understand what makes it all tick, you're in the right place. Because this isn't just about tech. It's about building a smarter, faster, more resilient world together.
Thanks for watching. Dive deeper into this conversation with an extended cut found wherever you get your podcasts. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and comment, and check out these other videos to learn more about the world of digital infrastructure.